Welcome, 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 welcome to our United service at this West of Cambridge ecumenical service. And we gather each year in late November, but we're gathering rather differently today. We might have all got rather used to engaging with one another through screens. And we definitely felt we will gather, we will have a united service. Even though we can't all be in the same room, we can actually unite in heart and mind. I should introduce myself. I'm the Reverend Bill Miller. I'm the minister of Cambourne Church. So you have here somebody who is serving as a Baptist minister and also an Anglican minister, Methodist minister and United Reform minister all in one. So don't you feel blessed? But here we are, united in Christ. One Lord, one faith. We sing together, we pray together, we heed God's word together. That's what we're here to do today. So, as we gather, let's become aware of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, do your work among us today. Let's worship God.
Thank you. Reading from Psalm 41. Happy are those who consider the poor. The Lord delivers them in their day of trouble. The Lord protects them and keeps them alive. They are called happy in the land. You do not give them up to the will of their enemies. The Lord sustains them on their sickbed. In their illness, you heal all their infirmities. O Lord, be gracious to me and raise me up. By this I know that you are pleased with me, because my enemy has not triumphed over me. You have upheld me because of my integrity and set me in your presence forever. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Amen and amen. Let us pray. Let us confess our sins to God. For our foolishness and our thoughtless use of the gifts of your creation, Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. For our neglect of you and our failure to care for others, Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. For our selfishness in prayer and our carelessness in worship, Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Here is good news for all who put their trust in God. Jesus says, "Your sins are forgiven." Amen. Amen. Thanks be to God.
And now we welcome Generate, who are going to be working with us and with our children today. They've prepared a programme for the children for today, for this morning. So thank you to Generate and welcome to you alongside us. And hopefully you have already received, if you've got children, information so that you can download and get those materials that are part of this session, as it were. But you don't have to do them during the service. Might be easier if you do them afterwards. That's up to you. But there is something for the children so that they can join together and worship together and learn from God together. But welcome, Generate.
I'm Steve from Generate. And when I was at school, I had hopes that I would be a famous footballer playing for Manchester City. And then when I was a bit older, that I would be able to retire at 50. But sadly, well, those hopes didn't work out.
And I'm Sean, and I had hopes that I would be a famous writer. And then later, that I would be a great cook, good enough to go on MasterChef. But, well, things took a different turn.
We all need hope. Hope is what keeps us going. Hope is what gets us through tough times. Hope keeps us looking to the future, to what lies ahead. But what happens when those hopes and dreams don't quite work out? When our hopes and dreams are just out of reach.
Over the last few months, we've all faced lots and lots of new challenges that we haven't had to face before, like not being able to mix with all our friends, having to wear masks, keeping our distance from other people, even those close to us. Many people have had to stay at home for long periods, and we've all had to live differently. It's been challenging, and in challenging times, it can be difficult to hold on to hope.
One night, a house caught fire, and a young boy was forced to flee to the roof. The father stood on the ground below with outstretched arms, calling to his son, "Jump, I will catch you. Jump, I will catch you." He knew the boy had to jump to save his life. All the boy could see, however, was, well, flames and smoke and blackness. As you can imagine, he was afraid and scared to leave the roof. But his father kept yelling, "Jump, I will catch you. Jump, I will catch you." But the boy protested, "Daddy, I can't see you." But his father replied, "But I can see you. And that's all that matters."
God can see us. You and I, God can see us. Ralph Abernathy said, "I don't know what the future holds, but I know who holds the future." God holds each of our futures, and so we can put our hope in him. The Bible tells us that we have a hope in God, a hope in Jesus, a hope for the challenging as well as the good times. In the Bible, it says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares God. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future."
A hope in God is a sure and solid hope that God will be with us. That God has a plan for us. That God has a good plan for us. A hope that can act as a foundation for our lives, for all that takes place today as well as tomorrow. When we have a hope in God, a hope in Jesus, we can be confident that even when things don't quite go to plan, they won't go pop.
They were so on wings like eagles.
None of us expected to be in this period of a lockdown when we met together last year. And an awful lot has happened among us and through us. And God is the same, and he's been at work in us and through us. Let's hear a little bit about what's been happening locally.
Wickham have kept contact with young people in Comberton and Cambourne Village Colleges and have continued to provide pastoral support to young people in Comberton digitally and where possible in person.
St John Fisher has been working with its sister churches. One thing we've done in particular is we've been sending out seeds and plants and also running a plant store so that we can fundraise for a peace garden in Caldecott, so that this time of Sabbath is one that actually leads to flourishing for us all.
In Hardwick, the churches and community work together to set up Hardwick Network, where volunteers help alleviate physical and emotional needs experienced as a result of lockdown.
At Compton Baptist Church, we put on an online holiday club for children in the local villages.
As soon as the official lockdown was finished, we gathered together volunteers from the village who came to rebuild the churchyard wall, as you see, and this proved to be a great lift for the village as they walked by on their daily exercise.
This year has been incredibly difficult for many people in our community, but we've been really lucky to see a partnership between the church, the community and the school. For children whose families get free school meals, we've been able to continue to provide them with vouchers or with food hampers during the school holidays to make sure that nobody goes without.
At Cambourne Community Gospel Choir, we were able to do a couple of virtual recordings that were put on YouTube, including an international collaboration with the Prince of Peace Choir from St. Etienne's Cathedral in Kigali, Rwanda, Central Africa.
In Cambourne, the Food Bank Distribution Centre continued its important ministry throughout lockdown as part of the Cambridge City Food Bank.
Let's continue in worship.
His love for me.
And now let us listen to God's word in scripture. And as Elaine brings us what God has laid on her heart for us.
In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who will judge the living and the dead, and in the view of his appearing and his kingdom, I give you this charge. Preach the word, be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. For the time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather round them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths. But you, keep your head in all situations, endure hardship, do the work of an evangelist, discharge all the duties of your ministry.
As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you remain in love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in love. I have told you this, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I call you friends. For everything that I learned from the Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command. Love each other.
The year 2020 has been a year like no other. And the predominant sense over the last 9 months has been that of loss. Loss of livelihoods, of jobs, of family businesses that have taken decades to build up. Loss of income. Loss of time spent with those we love, celebrating birthdays or anniversaries. Loss of services in church. Loss of confidence and hope and the future, and of course for many people, loss of life. For the carers and family and friends of those 52,000 people who have lost their lives in the United Kingdom to the coronavirus, life will not be the same again. And the emotional trauma of these months will hang over our culture for years to come. So how should Christians evaluate what's been going on? And how should we be responding for the future as to where we go from here? And I've noticed two very different responses that I want to share with you now. And the first is a negative response. It's to listen to the deniers, to the people who are indifferent, to the sufferings of others, to those who say this coronavirus has been overstated. It's nothing really. And we have the right, the liberty, to live our lives the way we choose and not have authorities telling us how to live. And so this response has meant we don't have to wear masks. We can go out in public. We can have rallies. We can associate with those we want to associate and so on. And of course, the result is the pandemic spreads. Because along with this attitude has been a despising of science, a kind of spiral of pseudoscience that has come in to take its place, showing how the coronavirus is of no importance at all. And in those cultures where this has been very predominant and often reinforced by government leaders, we have seen the toll in the death rate. The United States has 4% of the world's population, but 20% of the world's coronavirus deaths. And 11.3 million recorded cases of the virus infection have been recorded in a country so powerful and rich, with the access to the best technology, medicine and science in the world. But it's not merely indifference that's fueled the resistance to understanding the coronavirus properly, it's also religion. Because alongside the despising of science and the rise of pseudoscience has come the multiplication of new cults, with very definite ideas, distorted ideas about God and about power and about the battle between good and evil. And central amongst these cults is the rise of something called QAnon. And it began as an online activity in the United States, and then with the virus was imported across the world into Europe, especially Germany, and into the UK. And if you were in London in September, you might have noticed a big demonstration of thousands of people in the centre of the city, resisting wearing masks, resisting lockdown, and carrying multiple QAnon posters. So what is QAnon? Well, it's a massive conspiracy theory, and there are lots of things that get added to the mix. It has no factual basis. There's no evidence to support any of its claims, and yet its adherents are growing and multiplying in number, and there are now millions of them across the globe. At its heart, it believes that there is a Satan-worshipping paedophile ring. And the names of people involved in this ring are often bandied around, names like Barack Obama and Tom Hanks and Bill Gates and Hillary Clinton and George Soros and even Oprah Winfrey. And the fact that there's no evidence doesn't deter the adherents, because they believe in the end there will be a reckoning and all of these people will be gathered up together, they will be arrested, they will be brought to trial and imprisoned, and we will see that they, the adherents, were right. And how is this going to happen? Well, it's going to happen through Donald Trump, because Trump is envisaged as the one who is resisting evil and combating the paedophiles. And so adherents listen carefully to his speeches in case he's dropping clues to them as to what might happen next, or how he himself is contending and combating the deep state that exists beneath the state that we all live in and take for granted. I suppose it's not surprising that we should be aware of things like this happening at time of crisis, at time of trauma in our country and elsewhere. Because we've been warned about it too in the scriptures. It's not the first time that the church has had to combat even Christians being led astray by cultic ideas and wrong teaching. And in the letter to Timothy, this is spelt out very clearly. The writer says to the church, "I give you this charge, preach the word. Be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, encourage with great patience and careful instruction. For the time will come when people will not put up with sound teaching. Instead, to suit their own desires, they'll gather around them, they'll amass a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They'll turn their ears away from the truth, and they will be led aside into myths." This is actually a very common aspect that the church has to face through the ages, and we have to face it in our own age today. And therefore our responsibility is to come against myths like this, rather than to be swayed by them, and to help those who have become obsessed and in bondage to these ideas in their own lives. I said there were two responses I wanted to look at, and thankfully the second response is far more pervasive and far more Christian. It starts by acknowledgement of the truth. The truth about COVID-19 and the devastating impact it's had on our world and on the lives of millions of people. And that's followed by another acknowledgement, an acknowledgement of the importance of science. Science isn't the enemy. It's not pseudo or bogus. Science is a way of thinking God's thoughts after God and looking at the creation and getting to know our place in it better. And many scientists are people of faith whose work is dominated by their love of God and their love of other people and their desire to serve them. People like Francis Collins, who used to head up the Human Genome Project and is now heading up all the medical research on COVID-19 in the United States. Collins also quotes from 2 Timothy, but his quotation is a different verse, and I'll read it to you. "For God gave us," he said, "a spirit not of fear, but of power and of love and of self-control." Many scientists are people of faith. Ruth Bankovich, a scientist and a Christian in Cambridge, reminds us for Christians, every walk of life is a ministry of love. And that includes the walk of the scientist. She says this, "A scientist shows their love for God, for people and the rest of creation through their work in the lab. They pour themselves into their work wholeheartedly, trusting that God will guide and use their efforts to good effect. Notice how both of them use the word love. And love is that other key word that we've heard a lot of over these last 9 months. It's more powerful than hoax, more truthful than myth, more hopeful than loss. And love belongs to God. It emanates from God. It's what God has breathed into the creation and into our lives as members of the human race. We're made in the image of love. And so we love. It's our birthright. It's the deepest aspect of our human identity. And those of us whose lives are committed to Jesus Christ know something about the deeply spiritual nature of that love also. In our reading from the Gospel of John, Jesus uses the word love 8 times in about 5 sentences. It's obviously a very important concept. And I want to focus the rest of this talk on the 3 features that are singled out in those 8 times. Each one is so relevant to our lives in a pandemic. The first concept is of the abiding nature of love. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you, says Jesus. Now remain in my love. And what is it to abide in Christ's love? Well, it's not to be lured away into distractions, into conspiracy theories or myths or unlove or hatred of the other or apathy or indifference. It's to be able to discern the truth, to recognise injustice and inequalities in the system and want to address them. Abiding in love gives us resilience and courage and fortitude. And the second aspect of love is its mutual nature. My command is this, says Jesus, love each other as I've loved you. And this challenges the uglier tendency to always be on the lookout for number one. I bet none of us can forget that critical care nurse in York who, after a 48-hour exhausting shift, went to the supermarket to pick up some goods, only to find the shelves stripped bare of everything that she needed. And her tearful rebuke from the car, just stop it, stop it, was broadcast right through many homes. Well, a few days later, she broadcast again, and not everybody picked this up, because she had something very different to say. People have been very generous, she says. There's been an overwhelming response. It's been heartwarming. Why? Because we're made in the image of God, and because we are mutual, we're able to actually be empathetic and caring and stand alongside those who suffer. And the third aspect of love in this passage is its sacrificial nature. Jesus says, greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. And we've seen the sacrificial nature of love writ large during these last few months. Doctors, nurses, care workers, family members have given their lives for others as they've succumbed to the disease. Immigrant people coming to this country for a new life have given their lives up so that others can live. And why would they do that? Because they believe in God? Because they're motivated by Jesus? Well, yes. Many Christians are amongst those who have died in this pandemic while serving other people. But even more basically, it's because they're made in the image of God, who is love. Love is abiding, it's mutual, it's sacrificial, and that's what it is to be human. This second response then is one that's true to the gospel of Jesus Christ, and we need it. We need it to help us against the dangers of untruth and injustice and denial and evil. And may God bless all of us for the rest of this year and beyond, and enable us to fight myths and fabrications and hold on to truth and love and bathe ourselves in the warmth of God's compassion. God bless you all. Amen.
Thank you. I love that phrase Elaine has just used, bathing in God's compassion. Wow. So where have I encountered untruth and injustice and denial this week? And how can I speak truth into these situations in the coming week? and how can I demonstrate the warmth of God's compassion and love in the coming days? I'm going to move into song and then into prayer.
How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Jesus Christ, our living hope, we pray for the world you came to save. We pray for those who've been bereaved in the COVID pandemic and for those who are unwell with the virus. Bring them light, hope, and healing in their suffering. We pray for those making and enacting policies for controlling the pandemic, for those developing treatments and vaccines, and for those who are caring for others in hospital or at home. Give them the wisdom to know what to do, the courage to take the necessary steps, and compassion and gentleness in all their dealings. We pray for everyone whose lives are blighted by violence, whether through war or civil disturbance, or in their own homes. Raise up peacemakers to bring change, restoration, and the chance to live productive lives. Lord, who breaks every chain, yours is the victory. Jesus Christ, our living hope, we pray for the church you came to build. Challenge us to bring your message of hope to our world, and give us the courage, persistence and humility we need to rise to that challenge. Challenge us to see beyond the things which divide us and embrace the great truths which unite us as your body. Challenge us as we are set adrift from our buildings and our usual ways to discover in you our way, our truth and our life. Challenge us to deeper commitment to proclamation and service, so that by our words and our deeds we might demonstrate your gospel of hope. Grow your church in depth, in number, and in love. Lord, who breaks every chain, yours is the victory. Jesus Christ, our living hope, we pray for the communities in which you have placed us. We pray for the businesses in our town and villages. At this especially difficult time, may they have the community and government support which they need. We pray for the schools in our area as they work extra hard to keep our children safe while they learn. Protect all staff and students and make the schools places of happiness as well as education. We pray for our neighbours, the people we speak to, the people we recognise but whose names and lives we don't know. Help us to see in everyone a precious individual for whom you died. May our congregations be the beating spiritual hearts of our communities, propelling life and hope to all. Lord, who breaks every chain, yours is the victory. Jesus Christ, our living hope, we pray for ourselves, your redeemed people. Tear through the shadows of our souls and challenge us into genuine repentance. Give us such a hunger for righteousness that we will never stop seeking to be filled with your Holy Spirit. Give us such hope in your eternal salvation that we will be able to rescue others from despair. Give us such joy in your presence that others will see straight through us and encounter you. give us such peace in the storms of life that we may guide the feet of others onto your rock. Lord, who breaks every chain, yours is the victory.
And as Jesus taught us to pray.
Our Father in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Your kingdom come.
Your will be done.
On earth as in heaven.
Give us today our daily bread.
Forgive us our sins,
as we forgive those who sin against us.
Lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours,
now and forever.
Amen.
And now we come towards the end of our gathering. Has it warmed your heart? I think it warms the heart of God when his people unite together to worship him and to celebrate their unity, our unity in him. In a moment, I'm going to pray a blessing over you and we'll sing our final song. But first, I do want to just highlight a couple of things which are going to be happening. One, there's an opportunity to give, to make an offering, and details should be coming up on the screen about that in a few moments at the end of the service. But also there's an opportunity to gather together, to have fellowship over Zoom as well. And details about that should be coming up as well, if you haven't already got those. So may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May he look upon you with favour and give you peace. In the name of Christ. Amen.
Upon you and a thousand. children, may his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you in the morning and the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you. He is for you, he is for you, he is for you, he is for you.